braggadociously, and while we're living lavishly, and while we're living on the hog, we forget about God. But when we fall in a situation, then we start crying. I hear David cry, "For great is thy mercy toward me. Thou hast delivered my soul from the lowest pile of hell." In other words, I didn't realize the potentate, the great potentate, covers me. I didn't realize the great potentate loved me until I fell in a hole, until I fell in a mire. But David said, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for thou art with me. Your rod, your staff, and comfort me." David said, your great mercy has pulled me out of hell. Can I go down that road?
Yes.
Sometimes we hear preaching and we just let it slide.
Yes.
Not for me. God is a preventative God.
Yes.
Oh Lord God.
I wish somebody would speak to me.
Yes, Lord. Thank you.
He is a preventative God.
Yes. Yes.
He's not a reactive God.
Yes.
Right. That's right.
Though oftentimes he reacts because of our negligence.
Yes.
God is a preventative God.
Yes.
He cried, "If you hear my voice."
Yes.
Oh, somebody. "If you'll hear my voice, harden not your heart." You're going through the wilderness. You're going to meet some devils in the wilderness. You're going to meet some thirsty ground. You're going to be hungry in the wilderness. Call on me now, and I'll take you through all right. But if you go your own way, you shall die in the wilderness. Lord have mercy. David said, "Look, I'm not going anywhere without you, God. Be my refuge and my strength." He said, "Lord, I'm going to hide your word deep, deep down in my heart. I will never sin against you again. I did it wrong the one time. I did it wrong one time. And I'll never do it again. I'm going to be cautious. I'm going to be preventative. I'm going to stay on my knees. For I know you're the God of gods. And you're the King of kings. You're the ever-present help in time of trouble. For when I was in my blood, you didn't leave me in my blood. You picked me up out of my blood. You wash me. You cleanse me. You put on a new skirt on me. And you said live." And so I'm going to praise the Lord at all times. His praise shall continue. Be in my mouth. Death circumvented. I circumvented. Many men. It circumvented Abraham. It circumvented Adam. It circumvented Isaac. It circumvented Enoch. It circumvented Paul. It circumvented everybody. Our death circumvented. It binds. It pulls down. The steps standing by the grave, I cried, "Oh my God, my loved one's God." But if you know the man from Galilee, if you knew Jesus, the Bible says don't sit around crying for dead folks. Praise! If you know the souls is right with God, don't sit around crying, sit around praising. So David,
thank you.
Understood the magnitude or the ramifications of a sinful life. He understood the consequences of sin, the sins of the father upon the children. For death reigned from Adam all the way to Moses. Even over them that, the Bible said, had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression. But there's a gift from God. Tell somebody there's a gift from God. But God's free gift, the Bible said, is not at all to be compared to man's trespass. For while I was yet a sinner, oh my God, while I was yet a sinner, Christ died free gift set. You don't deserve this. You don't deserve salvation. But love. Love reached out its hand for me.
Such love.
Such wondrous love. That God could love
a sinner such as I.
Oh, wonderful. David understood it. And he mused on it. And so David, the great psalmist, wrote unto God at all times. And he told God, spoke to God from his heart. And he told God of the greatness, his love, and his mercies. For he saw that debt was raining all the way down. And he understood that debt would eventually circumvent him. Oh, God of mercy. When he looked back to that Genesis 2 chapters, and he said, God has already made a way out of nowhere. I want to encourage you this morning that God has already made a way out of nowhere. He might be dealing with cancers. He might be dealing with sicknesses. He might be dealing with ailments. He might be dealing with broken marriages and broken homes and broken heartedness. He might be dealing with struggles in your life. But God has already made a way. Way back from before the foundation of the world. God already made a way. It would seem as though there is no hope. But the devil is a liar. He's the father of lies. God has already made a way. I know you don't feel it now. But if you raise your hand to heaven and say, Lord, have mercy on me. I'm broken. Have mercy. I'm wounded. Have mercy. Oh, I'm rejected. But have mercy.
Mercy.
He will make a way. Oh, help me somebody. Help me, Jesus. This is profound. Because the book tells us, and the Bible tells us, about a scene at Golgotha. John, in the 19th chapter of his book, says that when Jesus realized that all of his intentions were complete, when he realized that the plan he had of redemption was complete, when he realized that there was only one thing left to do, when he realized that as he hung on the cross, they were jeering him and mocking him ignorantly, when he realized, amen to God, that the work that he had planned from the for the foundation of the world was almost done, the Bible said, hallelujah to God, hallelujah. Lift up his head. He said, Eloi, Eloi. He said, Lama Sabachthani. My God, why have thou forsaken me? The Bible said he lay there. He looked and he saw that the scriptures would be fulfilled. The Bible said that he cried out something very profound. The Bible said he cried out again. When he said, I thirst, I caught a revelation. For nothing that's said in Bible is without a revelation. Hallelujah. For this thirst that he cried for speaks to what I spoke about last week. For I told the brethren last week that there's no water in hell. I told them that hell and water in hell represents life. It represents that sustenance. You have to understand that without water, you cannot live. You need water to hydrate the body. You need water to keep you afloat. And without water, you will dehydrate and die. I told the brethren last week that there is no water in hell. Jesus on the cross now is crying, I thirst. In other words, he's saying, I'm about to die. I'm losing my life. My life is seeping away. He's dying on the cross. And the writer said, while I was busy doing my thing, he wasn't dying for himself. He wasn't wounded for himself. The Bible said he was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. We are sheep that have gone astray without this shepherd. He said he was led to the slaughter as a sheep without a shepherd. But he opened not his mouth. I wanted to tell you that the only time Jesus opened his mouth, it was when he cried, "I first." That means I'm dying for this world. I'm dying for these degenerates. I'm dying for these people. But though they're degenerates, I love them anyhow. For I made them in my own image, after my own likeness. And so Jesus cried out, "It is finished. It's time for me to die." Hallelujah to God. Water, water, water. You gotta understand what water is. Typologically, water represents life. In other words, Jesus was saying, "My life, my temporal, my temporal body, my temporal casing was going out. It was dying. It was about to be finished." And after that, he had cried. Hallelujah. The Bible said they brought him vinegar. Oh, Lord, Shandu. They brought him vinegar to quench his thirst. In other words, they wanted him dead. A fool and slow of heart to believe the gospel. Many times he was one of the preacher to shut up and leave us alone. But he's preaching for your own good. He's preaching for your own life. The message is not for the preacher, but he got the revelation. But he got it to tell you that somebody died in your stead. Somebody took your place. Somebody will do that for you. Somebody held the pangs of death surrounded his neck. I'm on my shadow side. And while the pangs of death surrounded him, the Bible said he hung his head and said, "It is finished." Mama, mama, shadow. As he said it, he bowed his head and he gave up the ghost. I know the devil got excited. I thought he was the Son of God. I wasted my time with this fool. I walked around and tempted him all these years. I told him to turn the stone into bread. I should have known that couldn't turn the stone into bread. You want to understand something, as I told the brethren on Friday. Death and hell are twins. Once death grab you, Hamamashanda, hell enlarged in itself and sucked you in. Hashandosa. So anybody who said Jesus didn't die, you're a fool. For the minute he died, he went straight to hell. But I want to tell you something about hell. Death said, "I haven't caught. Death said, "I haven't where I want him." He did good. Well, I'm going to tear him down. But you got to learn something about the word of God. The Bible said, hey, when death drop a hold and the pangs surrounded him, death tore off his veil and hell sucked his spirit in. But when hell sucked it in, he said, "Whoa, what is this? What is this? Yeah, this is not normal." For the S-O-N started to shine. The S-O-N started to go. Lord God. And the devil was on earth laughing and jumping and doing the boogaloo. But death was in trouble. Death thought it had him for 42 generations. For 42 generations. Death has eaten up every man. All the way down to Jesus. Death is insatiable. That means death can never be full. It's ever hungry. So keep fooling yourself. Think death won't suck you in. It's gonna suck us in. It's insatiable. It's ever hungry. It sucked in Jesus. What it sucked in him. He said, "Oh my God, who is this? Who is this glorious man? Who is this that struck down? Who is this righteous man?"